preface in Chapter 1 of Katharine von Bora, Dr. Martin Luther's Wife. Katharine von Bora, Dr. Martin Luther's Wife, by Armin Stein, translated by E. A. Endlich. Author's Preface. It has been my purpose in Katharine von Bora to picture in the peaceful quiet of his domestic happiness the man whose influence so largely shaped the course of public events. The undertaking has not been altogether an easy one, for while history flows in a copious stream regarding the reformer himself, it gives but meager information as to the great man's wife, the humble, modest woman who never thrust herself forward nor sought any personal advantage from her husband's greatness, but remained contentedly in the background, glad to do him service and to enrich her own heart from the abundance of his spiritual riches. Only occasional fragments give us glimpses of Catherine's life, and out of these I will endeavor to form a complete picture. The fact that Luther is so absorbing a personality gives rise to a further difficulty. The biography of Katharine von Bora often insensibly becomes that of Luther himself, and the author pauses to ask himself, am I writing of Katharine or of Luther? I can only repeat that it is my purpose in this book to paint Luther's domestic life, and therefore Dr. Martin, as the head of his household, may fitly play a leading part. As has already been stated, the historical notices regarding Katharine von Bora are very scant. In addition to the laborious compilation by Walsh, published in refutation of popish calumnies, there are but two learned works upon the subject, Hoffman's Katharine von Bora, or Luther as Husband and Father, and A Life of Katharine von Bora by W. Bestie. Besides these, I would mention a concise and popular sketch written by Muir, the Luther biographer. It has been my endeavor so to utilize the material here gathered that our people may learn to know the wife of its greatest man, not by name only, but as her husband's helpmeet in the truest sense of the word, as a pattern of domestic virtue and as a pearl among women. Book First, The Maiden. Chapter 1, A Conspiracy. It was the evening of a clear, warm March day. The sun, sinking behind the distant hills, sent its parting rays over the earth, tinting hills and valleys, forests and meadows, with golden light. The evening mist was rising and covering with a filmy veil the tender spring flowers, the snowdrops and violets, from the chilly night air. The windows in the western wing of the convent of Nipschen shone with a ruddy glow, and the face of the young nun, who stood by an open casement, seemed transfigured by the strange light, while the tears in her eyes quivered like drops of liquid gold. With longing sadness, her glance rested upon the landscape, upon the peasants returning to their homes after the day's work, and upon the children playing their merry games on the village green. The young nun was of pleasing, graceful figure. Her features were too irregular to be strictly beautiful, and the pallor of her skin made her appear older than she was. But her face possessed the rare charm of sympathy. Clear, thoughtful eyes and delicately curved lips betrayed a deep, rich inner life and a sensitive heart, while the firmly rounded chin bespoke self-respect and decision of character. An expression of gentle dignity lay upon the arched forehead. There was in her manner a certain high-bred nobility, the stamp of true womanliness, and her movements were full of grace. Her cell was narrow and gloomy, yet the skillful hands of its occupant had so disposed the scanty furniture and the saints' pictures upon the walls, adding here and there little touches of color, that the room had lost its bare appearance. The abbess herself was fond of visiting this cell and often said, "I cannot understand, Sister Katharine, why your cell is so homelike. One feels here that it is far pleasanter to come than to go." As the nun stood by the window, her tearful eyes rested upon the calm beauty of the early springtime, while her mind was lost in gloomy reveries. At her feet lay a piece of costly violet-colored velvet, which had dropped from her hands, and upon the window ledge were tangled masses of white and yellow silk. Rousing herself from her dreams, she hastily gathered up the velvet, sat down upon a stool, and resumed her embroidery. It was an altar cloth for the convent church. The design was two palm branches crossed, and above the legend, Ave Maria. The words were already finished, but the branches were merely outlined in coarse stitches. Her slender fingers moved wearily over the velvet, and her head bent low over her work, for the last scant rays of daylight were falling into the cell. Suddenly, the heavy, iron-mounted door was opened, and a younger nun appeared. "What is this, Sister Katharine?" she exclaimed in surprise. Still at your work? Pray spare your eyes. But, she continued, coming nearer, why are you so far behindhand? What will the abbess say? Tomorrow at high mass the altar was to wear its new draperies. Catherine looked up with a dreary smile. I am angry with my own heart because it is so reluctant to obey the commands of our superior. My needle moves slowly, and what was once a pleasure has become a burden. Oh, Sister Elizabeth, a change has come over my soul since the voice of the monk of Wittenberg penetrated these walls. Elizabeth glanced anxiously toward the door. Speak softly, Sister Catherine. These walls have ears. She pushed the bolt, and drawing a stool beside Catherine, she sat down, saying gently, light the lamp, sister. I will help you. How kind you are, dear Elizabeth, exclaimed Catherine with a grateful smile. But let us wait. It is time for vespers. As she spoke, the little bell was heard, summoning the nuns to evening prayers. Then followed the meager supper in the refectory. Both nuns were of noble lineage, for the Cistercian convent at Marienthron at Nipschen received no others. The younger one was Elizabeth von Kennitz, who had taken the veil but a year and a half ago. Her fresh, rose-tinted skin had not yet been blanched by the cellar-like atmosphere of the convent, nor her cheerful spirit crushed by the oppressive discipline of the order. Her ingenuous, childlike disposition had won the love of the sisters, and even the venerable abbess had been seen to smile at her merry sallies. Her friend was a descendant of the distinguished family von Bora, richer in noble ancestors than in worldly goods. She was an orphan, and knew but one member of her family to be living, her brother, Hans von Bora. She had reached her 24th year, and had been in the convent since her childhood, having taken the final vows at the age of 15. An hour later, we find them again in Catherine's cell. The copper lamp was lighted, and they sat down together to finish the embroidery which was to be used at the celebration on the morrow. "How swiftly your fingers fly, dear Elizabeth," said Catherine, "and how contentedly your eyes rest upon your work. You happy child! Life is all a fair mayday to you. Doubts and temptations are all unknown to you. You're satisfied within these gloomy walls, and to your childlike faith they seem to lead straight to heaven. I, too, was once happy and contented here, although I grieved sorely at leaving my father's house. Ah, it is hard to part forever from all that is dear to us, and to hear the convent gates close behind us like the lid of a coffin. To be dead to the outer world, never again to receive the kiss of love or the greeting of friendship. But seeing that it must needs be, for my parents, with their small means, could not provide a suitable refuge for their daughter, I overcame my sorrow and, with confident hope, knocked at these doors of which I was told that they were the doors of heaven. And truly it seemed as though a breath from heaven greeted me as I crossed the threshold. To be sheltered from the temptations of an evil world and from the cares of this life, to be surrounded by the odor of incense and the sound of holy music, to be guided at every step by spiritual counsel, to be able to labor unceasingly for the welfare of my soul and fix my thoughts upon the life to come. All this persuaded me that I had entered the courts of heaven, and I remembered my parents daily with hearty thanks for their kindness in bringing me hither. Now I see it all in a different light. This gloomy house, which I regarded as the abode of true life, is a grave, in which I am buried alive. The monk of Wittenberg has opened my eyes, and I see that all my pious exercises are but an idle, fruitless endeavor. Luther's words have startled me out of my dreams. But he is right. It was but a dream, an imaginary sanctity. My heart bears me witness to the truth of his teaching, for God's peace, which I hoped to win through my devotions and good works, that I have never found. I was taught that only in the convent true piety had its abiding place. I have learned this to be false, and I am certain that those who live in the world can serve God and be saved as well as we. Yes, if we who enter here could leave behind us our sinful heart, but that goes with us and prepares us trials of which the world does not dream. It would seem as though here everything were calculated to lift the soul above earthly things and to fill it with the strength of heavenly life, but in reality the dreary monotony merely deadens the spirit. Beyond these walls, life shines in bright and happy colors, but here all is gray. There, men rejoice in the lovely springtime. They watch for the summer, which causes the budding germs to flower. They greet the autumn with its ripening fruits, and again, when winter comes, the weary body hails the rest it brings. Here, we scarcely know when the violets are blooming, or when the grapes are gathered, or when the snow is falling. All seasons, all days are alike in this dull life, if indeed it can be called a life. There, men go forth each morning to their day's work, and it is a pleasure to them, a blessing, both to body and soul. Their food gives them strength, and their sleep refreshes them. But our souls and bodies are weakened by this pious idleness. If our convent were in a city, where we could nurse the sick, clothe the naked, comfort the sorrowing, that would fill the void in our life and vary its monotony. Ah, Sister Elizabeth, I fear I cannot longer endure the conflict. My strength is failing me, and I feel the blood coursing more and more languidly through my veins. She hid her face in her hands. A deep silence succeeded, which Elizabeth did not venture to break. Her tender heart was filled with pity at the sight of Catherine's misery. She had listened with deep interest, her glowing eyes fixed upon her friend's lips. Strange feelings were awakened within her. Now she rose in great agitation and grasped Catherine's hand. "Sister, has God bidden you to speak thus to me? Your words have torn the veil from my eyes and roused thoughts which hitherto slumbered in my soul. You think me happy, Catherine, and you are right, for God has given me a cheerful heart. But yet I am not the trusting child that accepts with unquestioning confidence the ordinances of the church and the rules of our order. Do you suppose that Luther's words have failed to touch me? Since I read his book on monastic vows and on the Babylonian captivity, a thorn has entered my conscience, which torments and terrifies me. My mind is not clear like yours to discern the needs of my soul. My trouble has been undefined, but you have put it into words. Now I know what I want, and I am indeed unhappy." She threw herself upon Catherine's neck and wept aloud. Catherine loosened the clinging arms, and wringing her hands in distress, she exclaimed, "Woe is me! What have I done? Oh, that I had kept silence and bore my sorrows alone!" Elizabeth dried her tears and said, with a gentle caress, "Do not grieve, dear Catherine. It is indeed painful to have one's eyes opened by force, but is it not better to know the truth than to continue in error?" After a long and scrutinizing look into her friend's face, Catherine suddenly leaned forward so that her lips touched Elizabeth's ear. "Elizabeth, you do not know all my trouble." The young nun's eyes anxiously questioned hers. She continued, "You will not betray me, Elizabeth. I have a secret, I and seven others." "Trust me," said Elizabeth. Catherine drew still nearer and whispered, "Do you know what has happened at Grima?" Elizabeth nodded. "How should I not know? The gospel has been preached there openly since Luther proclaimed the truth from the pulpit of the town church." "It is not that I mean," Catherine shook her head. "We have received tidings that in the past week the monastery of the Holy Cross was deserted by its monks." Elizabeth started. "What do you say? It is not possible." Catherine continued quietly. "These are wonderful times. All signs point to the beginning of a new life. Not at Grima only, but elsewhere also, the cloisters have opened their gates after Luther had uttered his Hefatha. Sister Elizabeth, if our gates were opened, would you go or stay?" A deep crimson dyed Elizabeth's face, and a shiver ran through her body. "Sister, I believe I should go, but," she added drearily, "who will open them? You know how bitterly the abbess hated Luther and how she rails against him?" A shadow fell upon Catherine's face, and a heavy sigh rose from her breast. "That is my sorrow also, but perhaps the abbess may be forced to yield, whether she will or not." "I do not understand you," said Elizabeth in alarm. Again, Catherine leaned over and whispered, "Eight of the sisters have entered upon a secret compact. They have written letters to their parents and kinsfolk, imploring them, for God's sake, to pity their condition and release them from their imprisonment. They say that since they have learned monastic vows to be opposed to the teachings of the Holy Scripture, they should imperil their souls by continuing to strive after an imaginary sanctity." Elizabeth's eyes were opened wide. She clutched Catherine's arm and asked eagerly, "Who are they, these eight?" Catherine answered, "They are Magdalene von Staupitz, Veronica and Margaret von Seschau, Lenita von Gohlis, Eva von Gross, Eva and Margaret von Schoenfeld. I am the eighth." "Let me be the ninth," pleaded Elizabeth. "If you go, I cannot stay." For a moment, Catherine's eyes scanned the young nun's face, and then she said earnestly, "Dear Elizabeth, we will gladly let you share our secret, but be careful lest you arouse suspicion. Your tongue is quick, and your eyes tell tales. A sudden flush overspread Elizabeth's face. Do not fear, dear Catherine. You shall learn that I can keep silence. Far into the night, the nuns sat plying their needles and talking over their plans until at midnight the little bell again called them to their devotions. End of chapter 1. Chapter 2 of Katharine von Bora, Dr. Martin Luther's Wife by Armin Stein, translated by E. A. Enlich. Chapter 2, Disappointed Hopes. Again it was evening, some weeks later, when seven nuns sat together in the cell of Magdalene von Staupitz. They were very sad, for the hopes which they had built on the kindness and mercy of their parents and kinspeople had been miserably disappointed. Magdalene von Staupitz had indeed received from her brother, the vicar general of the Augustinian order, a warm and sympathizing letter. And Catherine had just read aloud another from her brother Hans, full of tender brotherly love, but both urged their sisters not to leave the convent. Monks, they argued, might safely take such a step, being able to work with their hands for their bread. But how would they, poor, helpless nuns, fare in the world? Their second state would be worse than their first. The other nuns were even more cast down. Their parents had replied with threats and reproaches, and they were so utterly crushed that it was difficult to console them. Presently, Lynetta von Golis joined their number with drooping head and sorrowful eyes. Silently she sat down, and the eyes of all sat the face of Magdalene von Staupitz, who was older than the rest, and whose opinion was accepted with the utmost confidence. She had bidden the sisters to her cell to take counsel with them as to their further course. Magdalene rose. She was a tall, dignified woman with a thoughtful face and a calm manner. "Our first hope has been put to naught, dear sisters," she began in her rich, full voice. "And it is a bitter lot to be forsaken by those whom nature has appointed to be our helpers. They bid us remain, but shall we obey men rather than God, whose call has come to us through the word of his prophet? Our awakened conscience will not suffer us to continue in a place to which our heart has become a stranger, for all our obedience to the rules and exercises of the order is but hypocrisy." Catherine von Bora replied with quivering lips, "My spirit grieves at the thought of ending my days in this dreary place, dead while I am yet living. But what can we do? Listen to me, sisters. I will tell you my plan," she continued. "Since it was Luther who brought God's word to us, he is the man to whom we must direct our cry for help, that he may lay it before the throne of God." "Magdalene," cried Catherine, "how dare we? Should such as we burden the great man with our troubles? Has he not far greater and weightier cares resting upon him?" Magdalene shook her head. "Do not oppose me, Catherine. Through my brother I have gained more accurate knowledge of the monk of Wittenberg, and from what I have heard, we will not do amiss in turning to him. His giant spirit does not ask whether persons are of high or low degree. His ears and his heart are open to the needs of the least. Many of the monks who left their monasteries have been taken under his protection, and his energetic intercession has secured them a livelihood. Should he not take pity on us, defenseless nuns?" Eva von Schoenfeld eagerly grasped Magdalene's hand. "Sister, your advice is good, and new hope has entered my heart. I am sure that Luther will help us. I have absolute faith in him." A breath of excitement seemed to stir these troubled women. Luther's name revived and strengthened their failing courage, and they crowded around Sister Magdalene, thanking her for her happy, saving thought. "But how shall Luther hear from us?" asked Eva von Schoenfeld, when the sudden enthusiasm had given place to calm reflection. "That is the least of our difficulties," replied Magdalene. "Klaus, the gardener, will do the errand for me with pleasure. He has long been waiting for an opportunity to show his gratitude for the help I gave him when the poisonous insect stung his hand." Then the door was hastily flung open, and pale as death, Elizabeth von Kennitz rushed into the room. "All is lost," she cried, wringing her hands. "My father has come, and in the presence of the abbess, with many reproaches, gave me his answer to my letter. Our secret is betrayed, and I, unhappy girl, have been the cause." Burying her face in her hands, she sank upon a stool. The others, speechless and paralyzed with terror, surrounded her. Magdalene von Staupitz was the first to recover herself. "Sisters," she pleaded, "do not lose heart. They will make haste to separate and punish us. We will therefore use the few moments that are left to us and promise each other to abide by our purpose. Now more than ever, Luther is our only hope. Leave it to me. I will send a messenger to him." The nuns had scarcely expressed their assent when a shuffling step was heard approaching, and presently the abbess stood before the trembling sisters. The old woman's face, ordinarily of an ashen hue, had assumed a greenish tint which was an indication of the deepest anger. Quivering with rage, she struggled to overcome her agitation sufficiently to give utterance to her feelings. For some moments her lips were unable to frame the words, and in anxious silence the nuns, with hands crossed and heads bowed, stood like criminals awaiting their doom. Finally, broken sentences fell from the sanctified lips. "Oh, that my old eyes should witness such shame! What have you done, you children of Satan? If you stood before me as fallen Magdalens, as murderesses, from my heart I could pity you. But my soul revolts at your crime, and the sharpest scourge is too gentle for such as you. Only the day before yesterday, in proud joy, I reported to the general of the order, the convent of Marienthron is an undefiled sanctuary and proof against heresy. Now I am made a liar, my pride is humbled, my glory put to shame. Holy Mother of God, hide thy face from this iniquity, nor because of the sin of these nine do thou punish the whole of this consecrated house. Their crime shall be visited with heavy punishment, that the stain may be wiped away. But you, why do you stand on your knees with you into the dust?" The nuns fell upon their knees and silently kissed the withered hand of the abbess in gratitude for the promised punishment, for the convent discipline had taught them to receive punishment as benefaction. At the evening meal, and on the day following, there were 9 vacant places in the refectory. The penitents were locked in their cells on bread and water, and in the fervor of her holy zeal, the abbess undertook the task of listening at the doors to make sure that the prisoners recited the prescribed number of prayers. On the fourth day, the unhappy nuns were released, but only to be subjected to the deepest humiliation. During the celebration of the Mass, they sat apart from the others upon the penitent's bench, and while the priest intoned the penitential litany, they were obliged to creep upon their knees to the steps of the altar, striking their breasts with their hands, until the cleansing virtue of holy water and the fumes of incense had dispelled the odor of heresy. The abbess, after they had kissed her feet, then pronounced the formula of absolution, by which they were again received into the fellowship of the children of God. But it was her lips only that spoke the words. Her eyes expressed unappeased hatred, which imparted itself to the other nuns, and made the convent more than ever a hell on earth to the unfortunate heretics. They were passed by without a glance or a word, and treated as though they had forfeited the right of dwelling in this sacred spot. They were outlawed in the bitter need of their hearts, teaching them the insufficiency of prayers learned by rote, constrained them to cast themselves personally before the throne of grace, and, like Jacob of old, to wrestle with the Lord in fervent prayer. "Where is Klaus?" asked the abbess of the lay brother, who was busy with his spade among the vegetable beds of the convent garden. Slowly lifting his head, the brother answered, "He went away to buy seeds." "Where?" "He did not tell me. Probably to Erfurt." End of chapter 2. Chapter 3 of Katharine von Bora, Dr. Martin Luther's Wife by Armin Stein, translated by E.A. Endlich. Chapter 3, Dawn. In a corner house on the marketplace of Torgau, the merchant, Leonard Coppi, sat at the window of his comfortable room. He was a man past 50, with a shrewd, kindly face. His head rested on his hand, and his eyes wandered vaguely in the distance. From time to time, he moved uneasily in his chair and passed his hand across his forehead. He seemed to be pondering some weighty matter. His wife, Susanna, had questioned him repeatedly as to his ill humor, but either he answered her curtly or not at all, until she went away, highly displeased. Suddenly, the merchant rapped at the window and beckoned eagerly to someone below. A few moments later, a thin, elderly man entered the room. It was the chandler, Master Wolfgang Tomich, whom Leonard cordially welcomed. "It was a lucky moment for me, my good neighbor, when you passed my house. You are a man of wise counsel, of which I am sorely in need. Therefore I beckon you to come up to me." "Say on," replied Master Wolfgang, without moving a muscle of his face. Leonard loosened his doublet and prepared to tell his trouble. "Yesterday I returned from Wittenberg, whither I had gone on a matter of business. I also heard our dear Dr. Luther preach at the church of St. Mary's. His words still ring in my ears. Afterwards, I met Luther as he was returning from the church. He suddenly caught me by the sleeve and said, "Ah, is it you, my dear copy? My thoughts were with you this very moment, and here I see you actually before me as though you had dropped from heaven. This, it seems to me, is of God's ordering, and is a sign to me that you are the man to carry out the business which weighs upon my mind. You are acquainted in the convent of Nipshin?" When I told him that I supplied the order with cloth and wax, he continued, "Listen to me. In the convent are 9 noble maidens who are weary of their nunnery, but do not know how to obtain their liberty. In their need, after they had in vain petitioned their kinfolk, they turned to me for help, which I would gladly give, but that my arm is too short to reach from Wittenberg to Nipshin. Neither could I go thither myself and liberate the poor captives, either secretly or by force. Therefore, I have need of a man who will lend me his arm, and I ask you, Master Copy, to do it for the love of God. You know the road, and have a clear head to devise ways and means, and a good Christian heart that can pity the misery of others. Will you undertake the matter?" And I said yes, for who can resist the magic of Luther's wonderful lightning eyes and the pleading of his voice? I was proud, indeed, that he stood and talked with me thus publicly, the great man who fears neither Pope nor devil. But when he had gone, I felt hot and cold, for I perceived that I had built a tower without reckoning the cost. I pondered the matter on my homeward journey, and here I still sit and torment myself. The closer I look at it, the more ticklish it appears. How shall I disclose my plan to the nuns without arousing the suspicion of the abbess? Notwithstanding her 70 years, she has the eyes of a lynx and the scent of a fox. Even if I should succeed in approaching them unperceived, how will it be possible to get them away? If it were one or even two, it might be done, but a whole wagon full. And when they are safely out of the convent, we must still pass through the territory of Duke George. And that is a dangerous journey, inasmuch as the Duke hates Luther more than he hates the devil himself. Dear friend, what say you? Tomich half closed his eyes and nodded reflectively. After a moment's thought, he looked up and said, "The distress of these nuns touches my heart. Only lately I witnessed the joy of my sister's child, who escaped from the convent at Virgin. Such may be the joy of a person who rises from his grave, and methinks it is a good work and well-pleasing to God to help a human being from death to life. I pity the nuns at Nipshin, although they are strangers to me, and if Dr. Martin desires it, how can we hesitate? Therefore, neighbor, make the venture, and I will give you my help." "For which you have my hearty thanks," cried the merchant, wringing his friend's hand. "If you devise the plan, it will surely succeed." The chandler answered calmly, "It is a good work, and God will aid us. When do you carry the next load of goods to the convent?" "The order may come at any hour, for Easter is near at hand," replied Master Leonard. "What do you mean?" Tomich returned, "It must be an easy matter to deliver a letter secretly to one of the nuns." The merchant listened attentively, and after a little more conversation, the chandler left the house. On the following morning, a heavy canvas-covered wagon rumbled along the road from Turgau to Grimma, and on the evening of the same day halted at the gates of the convent Marienthron at Nipshin, about the time when the nuns were walking in the garden after their evening meal. Such an arrival from the busy world was an important event amid the monotony of convent life, especially when it was Master Leonard Coppi from Turgau, the pleasant, talkative man who brought an abundance of news and related such merry tales. For, strange to say, these brides of heaven greatly relished an earthly jest. As usual, he was soon surrounded by the nuns, and amid much cheerful talk unpacked his wares. But his eyes seemed to be seeking someone. He was absent-minded and failed to answer their questions. When at last Magdalene von Staupitz, coming in from the garden, approached the group, he grew taciturn and gave them to understand he was not in the mood for conversation. As Magdalene came near, a quick glance from the merchant's eye met hers. She turned away to hide the flush which rose to her face, and returning to the garden, concealed herself behind an alder bush near the entrance from whence she could overlook the court. After the nuns had dispersed, she again drew near and sought to find in the merchant's face an explanation of his look. Hidden from the convent by his great wagon, he hastily gave her a letter, saying, "Read it. At the appointed time, I shall be at hand." He then climbed into the wagon to prepare himself a resting place for the night, and the nun disappeared among the shadows. "What ails you, Sister Magdalene?" questioned the abbess later in the evening. "Are you ill? Your face is pale, and the rosary trembles in your hands." Magdalene cast down her eyes and answered softly, "I feel as though a fever were shaking me. My prayers wearied me, and my head is dull and confused." "Then see to it that some tea is made for you," said the abbess. Obediently, the nun left the presence of the dreaded superior, hastily swallowed the nauseous drink, and sought her cell to escape the torture of further questioning. She found Katharine von Bora awaiting her. "Tell me, sister," exclaimed Katharine, "what has happened? My heart beats with fear, but I dared not ask you in the presence of the others." With a sigh of relief, Magdalene bolted her door, then sank trembling into Catherine's arms. "Katharine, dear Katharine, the day dawns, the day of freedom. Luther, Luther, O thou prophet of the Most High, thou deliverer of the German people, thou wilt prove our good angel also." Catherine shivered within Magdalene's encircling arms. "Do not speak in riddles, sister," she cried. "Relieve me from this suspense." Magdalene drew a slip of paper from her bosom. "See here, the answer to our petition to Dr. Martin. Leonard Coppi, the merchant, gave it to me secretly. It is difficult to decipher, for Master Coppi's hand is not skilled in writing. Listen to what he says. Dr. Martin greets the nine sisters, and through me, Leonard Coppi, the merchant of Torgau, will restore them to liberty. Therefore, hold yourselves in readiness. In the night before Easter, on the 4th of April, at the hour of 10, I will be under Katharine von Bora's window, from whence escape is easiest. Do what is needful to keep the secret, and may the Almighty have mercy on you." Katharine would have cried for joy, but Magdalene's hand sealed her lips. "Restrain yourself, sister. If God is preparing a path of escape for us, our own imprudence must not throw obstacles in the way. Consider, our salvation or ruin lies in our own hands. Woe be to us if we betray ourselves and our deliverers." "What did you say?" interrupted Katharine excitedly. "In the night before Easter? God pity us! Is not that, of all times, the most unsuitable?" "You mean because of the vigil?" asked Magdalene, reflecting. Then, after another glance at the letter, her eyes beamed afresh. "No, that very night will be the most favorable to our plans. The vigil begins at midnight, and on that evening we retire earlier than usual to get a few hours of sleep. Here I read that the merchant from Torgau will wait for us at the hour of 10. Is that not wisely planned? Oh, my spirit rises with new courage, kindled by hope, and my last doubts are silenced." Overcome by her feelings, Magdalene fell upon her knees, and from the depths of her heart came her thanksgiving. "Thou, Lord of my life, thou, God of my salvation, I thank thee that thou hast guided a heart to accomplish our deliverance. I put my trust in thee, who wilt surely finish the work thou hast begun for thy name's sake. Amen." End of chapter 3. Chapter 4 of Katharine von Bora, Dr. Martin Luther's Wife by Armin Stein, translated by E.A. Endlich. Chapter 4, Freedom. It was Easter Eve in the year 1523. After the solemn hush of Good Friday, a bustling activity stirred the little community. The work was done in silence, it is true, for the day on which the body of our Lord lay in the sepulchre demanded quiet and reverence, but all hands were busy with preparations worthy of the highest festival of the Christian Church. Groups of nuns were binding wreaths of moss and cedar branches with which to deck the images of the saints and the life-sized statue of the Blessed Virgin, which occupied the most prominent place in the chapel. Others were engaged about the altar, which on Good Friday had been stripped of all ornament. They covered it with a cloth of white silk embroidered in gold and supplied the candlesticks with fresh tapers, which Leonard Coppi had lately provided. Others were building up on the altar recess a representation of the resurrection. The grave, surrounded by the prostrate watchers, and the Savior issuing from its portal, bearing aloft the banner of victory. The forenoon passed amid these preparations. The midday meal was eaten in silence, for the strict fast permitted but scanty refreshment. During the afternoon, the convent was silent as the grave. The nuns, weary in body and mind from the exertions of Holy Week, rested in their cells. Since Palm Sunday, they had spent but few hours in their beds, having been engaged day and night in praying, fasting, singing, confessing, and hearing Mass. Many may, therefore, have rejoiced in the blessed Easter day, not only because our Lord was risen from the dead.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.